Morning, it's 9:02, and we're going to call the July 30th Board of Examiners for Land Surveyors meeting to order. The notice of the July 30th and 31st, 2015 meeting of the Board of Examiners for Land Surveyors was published and posted to the Board of Examiners Land Surveyors website on July 20th, 2015. Well, I'm glad everybody's here this morning and everybody's bright and shining can make it. Our first item here will be to adopt the agenda. If you've had a moment to take a look at that and see if there's anything that we need best I think we need to put on here.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to amend the agenda to include the report from the TAPS organization. Mr. Jimmy Cleveland's here, and he can provide that for us.
To fit in?
I'd like to do that after the director's report is completed.
After the director's report, all right. Okay. Any other additions or deletions we need to do to the agenda?
Other additions or amendments to the agenda, I move we approve.
I'll second that motion.
Made and seconded. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right. The minutes to the previous meeting, the meeting of April the 17th, 2015. You have copies of that, and you've had an opportunity to go through and add to or delete. Edit and see if there's anything you want to change on it.
Mr. Chairman, if there's no changes by the members, I'd make a motion that we approve the minutes as written.
Second.
All right. Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? I'll say that there are some items on here that I intend to address, and I think that Mr. Kilgore is going to address some of these, and we'll bring these up as we go through the meeting today. Made and seconded. No other discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. The minutes have been approved. All right. Next item, election of officers for this coming year. So the floor is now open for nomination to elect officers, however we want to do that. And we say we'll do the chairman of the board.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate yourself, Galen Northcutt, as chairman for the following year.
Okay. We had noted that Mr. Hoffman has nominated me for chairman for the next year.
I'll second that nomination.
All right. Nomination has been seconded.
So moved.
All right. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor? Board, vice chair. All right, let's do the vice chair.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate Jay Kaufman as the vice chairman.
All right. Langefeld nominates.
So moved.
Second. Moved. Seconded. Any other discussion? All right. Go ahead, says Jay. You get take this. All right, then. I guess the next thing we have, Mr. Kilgore, is that, and everybody has noticed, Mr. Kilgore has changed his appearance. I will tell you that when I came in to see him on a case that we were reviewing, and I was sitting there waiting on them to come in, and he was coming back from lunch, and the young with him said, can I help you? And I said, well, I'm here to see Mr. Kilgore, and Josh was standing right there beside me. I was flabbergasted. So he has taken on a older professional appearance. Josh, thanks for coming
to
be
sir.
With us today.
Yes, sir. The first case here is case number 2015-011831, and actually it's two cases, 2015-011841 as well. I think we can address both of them at the same time, as it's against the same respondent and alleging the same violations. But these two complaints were filed alleging that respondent had been engaged in unlicensed activity and he used other surveyors' names, stamps, and license numbers to pass himself off as a licensed surveyor in multiple states. The first complainant here is a surveyor from Georgia alleging identity theft against respondent. Complainant furnished a survey showing complainant's stamp and what he claims is a forged signature. And the second complainant is an attorney familiar with respondent's past actions and discipline. Complainant 2 contacted Complainant 1 asking if he had prepared the survey that has his forged signature on it. Complainant 1 said that he had nothing to do with the survey in question. It appears respondent has been disciplined in Ohio, Rhode Island, and Pennsylvania for unlicensed activity or due to his lack of regard for licensing requirements in other states in relation to surveying. Respondent states in his response that all of this was a misunderstanding. He was asked to perform survey work by a client in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. Respondent states that due to a large volume of work, he immediately dropped another project and performed the Tennessee work. Respondent never addresses the fact that he is not licensed in Tennessee. He states complainant one and he, who he is accused of forging the signature and seal of, have had a long business relationship and that he prepared the initial survey to be reviewed by complainant one, but that never happened despite respondent forging complainant's name to it. Respondent states he is about to retire and he is embarrassed and has apologized to complainants and the board in this case. Despite respondent's apologies and excuses, it is apparent that a survey was conducted for a client in Tennessee despite respondent knowing he was not licensed to do so. Respondent also made an attempt to forge another surveyor's signature and seal, which he knew to be licensed in Tennessee, to pass off work to the client. All of this despite being disciplined for similar actions by other states in the past. Therefore, my recommendation is authorize formal and send a consent order with civil penalty in the amount of $4,000 to resolve both complaints, which would be $1,000 for unlicensed practice in violation of TCA 6218-101B, and that would be two violations of that, and then $1,000 for misconduct in the practice of land surveying in violation of 6218-116B. Thoughts on that?
I'm sure we all do have thoughts on that one.
Josh, real quick, explain to me, and I'm sure it was in here, I just missed over it, the
I think it was one, but it's two complaints. So it's actually
two complaints on the same survey?
Yes.
So one survey was completed.
Well, it's one survey, but then we had two separate complaints come in from one from the licensed surveyor whom he forged the signature of, and one from an attorney who knew that it wasn't the correct signature.
That's kind of my question. It sounds like, you know, if you're going to discipline him, there was one infraction. Now, two people made the complaint. If it was three, if it was four, if it was five, it was still one infraction.
Yeah. You're right. I mean,
so I'm curious to ask basis of my question. Why are we penalizing twice for one offense?
Well, I have two remarks. One about that. I'm going to address that one first, and I'll ask the second question later.
Sure.
According to our statute, it says the board may consider such factors in civil penalties. And one of those factors is whether the amount imposed will be substantial economic determined. And I feel like that allows this board to exceed. I think you're correct in the question you've asked, Mr. Kaufman, but I think that also allows this board to exceed what the stated penalties per that statute are. Now, that's a Josh question. I mean, he's our legal advisor on that.
I think statutorily you're limited to up to $1,000.
$1,000 per violation.
Per violation. So I may have been incorrect in my calculation there. So Mr. Kaufman may be correct that we could do up to 2,000, which would be 1,000 per violation, which I think is the statutory maximum.
And there's also a situation. I mean, like I say, when you look at the way it says in determining the amount of any civil penalty, you know, there's also a situation that this respondent had economic gain from the work that he did.
I think one reason for my amount was I don't know that 2,000 would be a significant deterrent, but at the same time, we have to follow the statute. However, I mean, he wasn't exactly forthright with the board, but he didn't disclose the fact that he'd been disciplined for this stuff in the past by other states. He didn't mention or he didn't address the issue that he's not licensed in Tennessee. He just kind of skirted around that and said, well, I have a business relationship with this surveyor, and you know, I guess I'm to assume that he had his seal from doing work in the past or something. I have no idea.
Well, that actually leads to my second question, and I know we're still batting this around a little bit, but my second question is it the intention of your office, Josh, to send any type of letter to the complainant relative to the misuse of his because it appears to me, again, we don't know all the facts here. Mm-hmm. It appears to me that it said in your writings, it said the first complaint is a surveyor from Georgia alleging identity theft against the respondent. Well, that leads me to believe that the surveyor from Georgia is licensed in Tennessee since the work happened in Tennessee. So it's my opinion that if we don't have a complaint against him, the board should have a complaint against him for allowing this activity to happen because that falls under our rules of conduct.
I don't think that he allowed it to happen. I think that
it doesn't matter. That doesn't matter in my opinion. You know, if someone takes my seal or let me give you a good example, something very readily that can happen. An individual works for me that does AutoCAD drafting, and we use an electronic version of my seal in the AutoCAD drafting, and that individual leaves my employ and takes that. Obviously, that's a civil issue, but if he is using it in a manner similar to this, then I think that in that respect that I should be somewhat, alerted / disciplined by this board. So I think the complainant's got a dog in this race too, because your seal is not something that you just freely leave laying around or is accessible to just anybody. Even though he mentions that he had a business relationship, I understand that. But clearly this individual has never been licensed and has been multiple disciplined.
I think he's licensed in other states, but not in Tennessee. But I'm not really sure I follow. We're going to open a complaint against the individual for allowing his seal to be misused, because I don't think that he willingly allowed it to be misused at all. I think it was – I don't know how this individual got the seal I don't think the signature was close. I think that he just wrote a signature on there. I mean, I don't have any evidence showing that the complainant in any way – aided the respondent in using his seal.
I think we need to kind of focus back in on the original issue here. Mm-hmm. And I'm not disagreeing anything with either of what y'all are saying. I think it's a separate issue on a tangent maybe that can be addressed at some later point. But I think for this particular case number, I think really I personally don't see anything wrong with the recommendation from you, Josh, other than the possibility of it being actually two separate incidents as opposed to just one. And I'm kind of the opinion that really, yes, there was a violation, but it was only once. The fact that there was two complainants or four or a dozen really doesn't matter. There was really only one violation or two violations one time, if that makes sense.
Right. Well, we may be able to go up to 3,000 for him not responding to the complaint adequately. So I mean, we could probably do $3,000 for not being forthright in his response to the complaint.
I'm not going to disagree with you. I think that's probably really subject to a lot of opinion. You know, I'm sure he'll have a different opinion than yours on that particular matter. But right now, I think there is no question, based on what's been addressed to us right now, that the offense for the unlicensed practice and also the misconduct of the practice in violation of the two codes is without question based on what's addressed in front
right.
of us.
And I would note that he's been suspended in another jurisdiction before.
That certainly adds to it.
And one of his excuses was that he's about to retire, so therefore we should dismiss this complaint. So I don't.
That doesn't fly.
Yeah, no.
I don't think that flies either.
And I guess the other thing is, once these complaints are finalized, are they being sent to NCWS, Donna?
They will be, yes, sir.
So to clarify, if I may, are we at a $3,000 civil consent order and a $3,000 civil penalty? Is that where we're at?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And I agree with Mr. Kaufman. I mean, it's one offense, and by statute, we got to deal with one offense. And clearly, in my mind, $3,000 is not a financial deterrent in this issue, but that's what the law allows us to do, so that's what we have to do. But if that's where we're at $3,000, I'd be glad to make a motion. But I would, before I make that motion, I would like to revisit my other question after that motion, if that's all right. But I'll make a motion that we approve the attorney's recommendation that has been revised to an amount of $3,000 for the disposition of this complaint with a formal consent order, and that being the penalty.
That motion's been made. Actions of our rules and regulations. Is there any other discussion?
I just want to clarify that the $3,000 is a total of three separate violations, each of $1,000. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I'm with you. Yeah, I'll second that.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Aye. Okay. Now, if I could go back to my other question, Josh, about the complainant. I feel, in my understanding of our rules of conduct, that a licensee is responsible for the care and use of their stamp. And I feel like that whether or not this individual had a prior relationship with the respondent or not, he in some form or fashion has allowed the respondent to have some possession, whether it be electronic, a physical stamp, or whatever means it was, some possession of his stamp, such that this situation could have occurred. So having said that, I feel like that the legal department should send the complainant a letter at a minimum. I'm not suggesting that we may not have any complaint history. And if he doesn't, I think a letter is an appropriate action. And I know we have several different forms of letter. I would think that probably a letter of warning, I don't know what Jay and Galen think, and they may not even disagree with my, I mean, they might not even agree with my direction either. But I would think that a letter of warning should be sent to the complainant relative to the care and use of his stamp.
Yes, the board. I've been listening to the discussion on this topic, and I just want to go back to discussions I've heard previously about licensees and their responsibility to inform the board when there's any misconduct on the part of licensees. And you've held your professionals to a very high responsibility on turning in any misconduct. And I wonder if in this instance where someone has turned in someone in for misconduct, seemingly of the worst sort, potential identity theft, which is a crime, that we might be undermining that very same standard where we want people, our professionals, to feel like they can come to the board and tell the board when there are bad actors in our profession without fear that the board is going to turn and say, now we might consider what you've done irresponsible also.
Yeah, Nicole, you make a very good point, and I'm not disagreeing whatsoever, but I do think that a form of letter should be sent to the complainant here, not a disciplinary letter, more of a informational letter or a reminder of rules and regulations. You are responsible for, you know, your stamp and the use of it. But I don't think it should be used in a disciplinary action, rather as a notification or educational type matter.
Perhaps then, if I may continue, instead of having Josh send the letter, because Josh can be very scary, maybe it should be me as the director of the program, just as a more advisory letter, with no disciplinary attachment to it, just saying, you know, the board has considered the complaint and we just want to make sure that you're aware that the board takes security of your seal very seriously, and we want you to, and however the board wants that phrased, I can write a letter, and this in no way is a, I can come up with something very well worded on behalf of the board, but without it being attached to the complaint process or discipline, just have it somebody sending out an administrative letter as opposed to talking to somebody and saying, I'm here to scare the dickens out of you.
I'm going to interject some things here because obviously we can't control the public. And I'm a surveyor that has retired, but I happened to be office one day or in a copying survey, and he cut his seal off of the survey, and this was just a John Q. Public, and put it on one that he had done to turn in as a site plan, claiming that the surveyor is the one that did it. I can't control that. Would open that particular surveyor up for any disciplinary ever of this happening. John Q. decided, hey, I'm going to do this, and I
this guy may not have had any. He just may have been, unfortunately, somebody who got his signature or seal grabbed, and this guy could just be making up a fishtail.
The question that I did not get answered, Josh, was, what is the complainant a registered Tennessee surveyor?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. But again, I'm kind of leaning on towards Nicole and Mr. Northcutt's, you know, it could have just been that he got some electronic copy of a survey that this guy had done and printed it off and made copies of it somehow. I mean, we can't control what a bad actor is going to do.
But I think at the end of the day, it's not who writes the letter, as far as I'm concerned, is that the letter gets written. Because I think it's our obligation as the board to let's use the word advise, registrants, if there may be an impropriety, not that there was, but if there may be. And if we do that as a board, I think we're doing our job to keep from having this complainant being before us at the next meeting in a presented complaint or something. You see what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. So,
in this situation, I'm sorry, if I may, this situation, with the past history of this respondent, he was going to do it. He's already done it three times. I don't know that this complainant could have prevented it if he tried. He's already done it in other states. If you got somebody who's going to steal, he's going to steal.
In the spirit of the direction you're going, if he'd done it in those other states, chances are this complainant knew about it, and you know, shame on him for even hiring the guy to start with. But that's neither here nor there. But again, my point is, I think that we all agree that a letter should be sent. It's not a detrimental. It's not a formal type thing. But it's simply a notice. And I think that's part of what we should do. That's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, I mean, generally, I think legal would call that a letter of instruction, and it wouldn't have any discipline attached to it.
Exactly.
So.
Exactly. I think that probably is.
Okay. I never remember all the instruction, warning. The letters I don't remember because there's like four of them.
Mm-hmm. Well, then let me say this to keep from belaboring the point, unless there's something else you need to add to that. Caution, because these things happen.
If I could request that letter to be sent to the board members here for review before it gets sent out, just so they can make sure that it reads right correctly and that the intention of what we're trying to address is relayed through the letter. Is that possible? You're just an email type. If it's possible, it'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. So,
having said that, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion either the legal or the staff prepares this letter, sends it to us for review, and then it'll be forwarded on to the complaint.
All right, motion has been made.
Second.
And seconded. Any further discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, thank you, Nicole.
Okay, and the last matter on my legal report, this is a represent. It's been before you couple months ago. I think it was the first meeting that I took over. This is case number 2014-025951. There's no further complaint history against this particular respondent. And after we sent out the original consent order for $1,000 regarding incompetency in the practice of surveying, other background information was obtained from respondent and his attorney, and the decision was made to have our expert reviewer meet with board counsel. And upon meeting with the expert reviewer and discussing the circumstances surrounding the case with the respondent's attorney in more detail, it was determined the matter should be informally reviewed by a board member for a second opinion regarding any incompetency or misconduct in relation to the survey completed. I think it's important to note that the survey completed was done for a third party and that the complainant was not the client. The subject property has been in a long, ongoing legal dispute, and no other surveys performed for complainant by other surveyors were to her liking. The findings that complainant wants to have, or the findings that complainant wants, have not been upheld by the court, and it appears that respondent survey was adopted as a correct representation of the boundary of the subject property by the court. Respondent was hired as an expert witness for trial by the third-party landowner, and the survey conducted was not a retracement survey as our expert originally contended, but it was the setting of the boundary as interpreted from various deeds after much of the land had been separated and parceled out over a long period of time. Some of the deeds contained errors and needed other old deeds to compare and give an accurate picture of the boundary as it exists today. Also, in the opinion of the reviewing board member, it was determined that there is no evidence to show any incompetency on part of the respondent regarding the conduct of the survey performed in this matter. Therefore, my recommendation is that the board close.
I'm kind of curious. There's a statement made in this. It says, the survey conducted was not a retracement survey, as our expert originally contended, but it was the setting of boundaries as interpreted from various deeds after much of the land had been separated and parceled out. What is the difference? That's exactly what a retracement survey is. I don't understand.
Maybe that's my misunderstanding, but the respondent was adamant that it was not a retracement survey. and he was preparing it for the court as an expert witness, and the complainant is not going to be happy regardless of what happens, because no surveyor that has gone out to this property has found what she wants to be found, because I don't think that it's there. And I think she fired all those other surveyors and probably filed another complaint, which was closed as to another respondent involving the same land dispute. And I mean, it's been ongoing for years.
You know, I understand that, you know, that anything that's in litigation, you know, relative, this board has nothing to, we don't have a dog in that race. But if there was a violation that we reviewed and we authorized hearing and penalty, then I felt like that we authorized that on some basis. And for that statement to be in here, I certainly can't be in favor of the recommendation.
Okay. Well, Mr. Northcutt was the board member who reviewed this matter, and while he can't participate in the final recommendation, I think that he could speak as to what his findings were after his review.
Let me tell you guys, I reviewed this thing, and there's a good bit of information. And finally, I did get a copy of the plat.
Can you clarify perhaps some of the question that Tim addressed in terms of you know, this not being a retracement survey? Can you kind of clarify that for us so we can get a better picture?
I think the retracement, and this had to deal with. For this particular piece of property. Opinion, I'm not sure that the retracement survey is not
well, maybe I was confused in my wording of it there, Mr. Wingerfelt, but I still, regardless of that language in there, I still feel that there isn't enough to go forward with discipline for misconduct or incompetency, just based on the evidence that we've seen. And, you know, there's been, I don't know how many experts have looked at this particular piece of land now, but apparently none of them, yeah, five or so, and that's counting our expert as far as looking at the plat, and Mr. Northcutt, and there's, I don't think that it rises to the level of misconduct or incompetency in practicing land surveying.
Well, I, at this point in time, I do not disagree with you at all, because of hearing Galen's explanation. It helps, you know, the problem that I've had with the expert witness, and I understand why we have them, has been that more often than not, we don't seem to get enough details. I feel like that, you know, we get this piece of paper handed to us when the meeting starts. We have it cold turkey. And we basically just have to rely, and hopefully we ask the right questions. Sometimes maybe we don't ask the right questions, just simply because of the flavor of the discussion or whatever. So, you know, Jay makes a good point. I think that I think from time to time I know the department does not want us to meet the expert witnesses. But from time to time, I think we need to review what we as the board hope or anticipate to be provided from the expert witness in the review of a case. I think that the board has that ability to do that, even though they're not in the room, if that makes any sense, because that's basically the way they came about. We gave some initial criteria in the beginning, and we had an enormity of problems when they first started because of some of the issues that I just brought up. And I think that it's appropriate for the board from time to time, whatever that may be, if it's an annual basis or every couple years or something, to kind of review that structure. Because we as the board don't know if it's the same individuals we started with or they have changed because of state contractual scenarios. And so we don't know that, and rightfully so. And that's fine. I have no problem with that. But I think that it's important that we're able to get enough information that we don't – I don't want you to feel like we're trying to grill you over it. And I know I'm probably the only one that throws that appearance out. But, I want to be able for the respondents, I want to be able to make sure that we make the appropriate decision based on the facts we're presented for that respondent and for the profession,
right,
and the public.
Yeah.
Because that's what our charge is. And that's the only thing that I'm saying.
Right. And I mean, back to your point, I mean, when things are in litigation, certain things come to light after. I mean, we only have the purpose of the legal report and the board's authorization of discipline is simply, is there probable cause for discipline? And that's not a very high threshold to meet. But then, a lot of times when we come back to represent something, it's not because, we're happy to go forward and carry out the board's wishes, but here I don't think that we want to get into a formal hearing over the allegation of misconduct and then, kind of in a sense be blindsided with, well, and then the board sitting there going, well, here we are at a formal hearing, but I don't see any misconduct. And, why did it get to this point? So that's really the only reason.
I think it was handled very well by you asking a board member to review it. I think that that was very well, and Mr. Northcutt's explanation, does it for me. No problem.
I kind of have to agree with Tim, too. I think that our expert witnesses, I'm wondering if having a, quote, continuing education thing just for them. What we as the board would like to see when they give us the paragraph does not give us sufficient information, and when I reviewed judge this man, and I don't even know what he's produced, so that probably not going far enough and giving sufficient information.
I mean, I can look at what our contract says and get with Colton Klein, who's the contract attorney for our department, and see, what it says. I mean, we have the ability to review those things, so, I can certainly do that. And,
meet with us, and we could give them
I just don't know what the process is for that, but I could certainly look into that.
I agree. There is certainly always more information that we could use, and obviously this is a prime example of obviously a decision we made in a prior meeting that in light of staff attorney's review, the additional information that was brought to light, obviously a review by yourself, that obviously opinions may have changed, and right decision, which I think is really why we're here. With that in mind, I would like to kind of focus back in on this case. Mr. Chairman, if I may make a motion that we...
Well, let me... I can't vote on this, so...
Fair enough. You can recuse your vote.
Well, let me make... Since you're now chair at the moment, Jay.
That's it.
Let me make the motion. Your moment in fame here. Okay. Mr. Vice Chairman, I'll make a motion that we approve staff's recommendation to this case and close it.
I second it.
All right. With a motion and a second, any further comments or questions? If not, take a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Hand the gavel back to you.
All right.
That concludes the legal report. I did have the military applicant rule that I think I passed out. Mm-hmm. Do you all have a copy of that? Okay.
Josh, has there been any changes to this since we last reviewed it?
No, there has not. I think that the only reason I'm bringing it back is because I have to be honest, you guys are the last board in the department that has not approved these as written. And I'm being told that, you know, they have to get done. This is something, unfortunately, that, you know, and when I first took over, I don't think that the rule was drafted as it has been approved by all the other boards. And so that's why I brought it back to you at that first or second meeting. I know that you guys had some questions regarding, you know, the board's interpreted duty to issue temporary licenses, because I know that a lot of the boards have had some reservations about that. However, the language says that, you know, you may issue a temporary license. I think the board still has discretion there, but this is the language that has to be passed to be in compliance with what the legislature has passed, which is the TCA Title 4, 3, 1304. And, it's one of those things where all of the other boards have adopted this, and it's gone up and start almost finished through the AG review process. And I do understand your reservations about the temporary licenses, but I think that the way that it's written is, you know, that's an option for you to issue a temporary license, but it's not a, you know, must do. It's a case-by-case basis review. So the board still has, you know, you only issue the license, and I don't know how many of these we're actually going to get, because, I mean, how many military applicants have you? Well, I mean, so it's not.
As I recall, Josh, we looked at this thing in April, and we're going to approve it. Wasn't this language?
Oh, okay.
I mean, that's what my,
okay.
We had no problem with it. We were going to approve it.
All right.
But it was pulled from us to approve because the language wasn't what was on this piece of paper.
Oh.
As I recall, and I may be incorrect.
Okay.
Hey Josh, is it my understanding this is the same verbiage that's used in the engineers board and all the other boards that are adopting? I mean,
yes,
verbatim,
sir.
It is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I don't think we had any problem with it,
oh,
but it got pulled from us.
Okay.
None whatsoever. Yeah.
All right, Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the military personnel and spouses as written and provided to us.
I'll second.
All right. Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Take it to the publisher.
Okay.
Thank you.
Josh, you've got one other item on there about this laws and rules examination that was brought forth, and you were going to get back to us after you investigated what the engineers do with theirs.
Right. I mean, I think my understanding. Right. And I think that my understanding is, I mean, you guys can go forward with the one that you've developed. My understanding is all they do is mail it out to their respondents, licensees, and basically, I mean, we know that it's open book, but the important part is that they actually look at the law book and the rule book and refresh their memory on that, because I think that's what the board's purpose in wanting to issue these is, and then they simply turn them back in within a certain amount of time. And once they do that, then they've met the requirements of the consent order or whatever the, you know, I guess it would be like a consent order where you say, you know, send the disciplinary exam attached to the consent order and say you submit this within 30 to 60 days. 30 days probably would be sufficient. And then assuming that they do that and that they can pass it, then I don't really, and I mean, I'm assuming that they could if they're looking at the rule book at home. But I mean, the whole purpose is that they're looking at the rules.
Again, they need to have the book.
So. Right. Well, when I say rule book, I mean online, wherever it may be, electronic, but yeah. So that's my understanding of how it's implemented.
Do we need to formalize that so that the next time we have an opportunity to use that as
I just wanted to follow up on the second part of that conversation we had previously. We don't have
but, you know, at least they're looking at it, so.
Okay. Mr. Chair, if it's appropriate, I'd like to make a motion that for future disciplinary actions, when the board deems it appropriate, that the laws and rules examination, that it be available for the board to include in a disciplinary action, if I say that correct.
Further discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
That would only be for consent, right, Josh? Just consent.
Yeah, I mean, I believe that would be.
Only
I don't.
Consent.
Yeah, I mean,
can't use it for formal hearing.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I don't think that if the board's issuing a, I don't think that if. I mean, my understanding is if the board's issuing the disciplinary exam as the only discipline that it's understood, that I don't think it's going to go to a formal hearing.
I
would think that it's just to make sure that he refreshes his
right
mind on what's in the book and what's required of him.
Right.
Unless the respondent fails to do what Josh asked.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, and then it would be a failure to respond to the board, I think, and that would be another issue.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. I just want to make sure I'm clear so when we move forward, I can kind of, because I think in a formal hearing, you only have the ability to do civil penalties.
Or suspension.
Revocation. I think that's there's very narrow parameters of what you can do to someone in a formal decision. Okay.
I had one more matter that came up subsequent to this, and it falls under legal, so if it's okay, I can go ahead and discuss that.
Proceed.
There is a, was it a complainant? Okay, I just want to make sure I get that fact straight. There's an individual licensee who is extremely, for some reason, agitated about two particular complaints that have been reviewed by this board. I don't know how many times, because I would just want to say once based on my review of the file, but Nicole seems to remember that it's been before you a couple of times. But I couldn't find any documentation to show where it was ultimately dismissed. I know it was closed, the two matters. And apparently this licensee, as a member of the profession and the public, has been writing letters over a period of years. He's written to his representatives and everyone that he can contact regarding these two particular complaints, but he's adamant that the board or the expert reviewer did not properly or adequately review the documentation in relation to these two cases. And we've written letters stating that the board has already reviewed these matters and that the decision has been made to stand by that and leave matters closed. However, he's become more and more insistent that we review it, and I took it to my supervisors and made them aware of the situation, and the suggestion was made because he actually wants to appear before the board at your next meeting and discuss his version of things. And I think that he's tried to supply the board in the past with, you know, a packet of evidence or whatnot to your individual addresses. And then he subsequently got mad at me and threatened to turn me into the Board of Professional Responsibility because I had received your mail, which, as your attorney, I don't understand what possible ethical violation that would be, but that was his stance on the matter. So the suggestion by my supervisors was that a board member review the two cases in question that had been closed, and kind of like Mr. Northcutt did with that last case, give their informal opinion about whether or not the matters should, whether there's anything in there that constitutes reopening them, and if there was, if there could have been a finding for discipline that was not found previously. I guess my suggestion is Mr. Northcutt took the last one. So if Mr. Lingerfelt or, someone, Mr. Kaufman would like to take these two files that I can get to you, anytime after this meeting, but before the next meeting, and give you ample time to review them to see if there's any reason why they should be reopened.
It's not just the two files, actually. Person complaining in this situation. There was a property dispute, and there were several land surveyors involved. One of the surveyors. And there was multiple complaints opened around the same time period. Each of the complaints were closed or dismissed because there were not decided that he was not disciplined, but he is outraged that the board did not discipline the other two. I've written so many letters explaining the board's decision, telling him that the information's online, providing him a copy of the minutes, summarizing the complaint process, rules, all kinds of information.
Do you think
That we don't know, and that is another issue. He has tried unsuccessfully to get copies of the expert witnesses' files. He claimed that it was a public record. It's not. It's part of the legal's files, so that is confidential information. He's tried multiple times to get that. He tried to go through the representative to get the public to get the. He's really shaking swords on this one. I mean, he's outraged, and he's going to come before the board next month because it is, I mean, that's what his plan is to come before the board.
Statement, a question. Prior to the expert witness scenario, the old rule of thumb, and I know Donna will remember, the old rule of thumb was when we actually reviewed cases and presented them back. The board would take on cases, for example, if it was in West Tennessee, Middle or East would do it, and vice versa, however it was. So it was not somebody in your neighborhood. That's the only thing I might say about, you know, who, whether Jay and I look at it, because it would be better if it was not my neighborhood or his neighborhood, if that makes any sense. Yeah. But the most important question that I will ask is, were these two complaints, were they closed with, I think Rob used to use the word prejudice, were they could either be reopened or they couldn't be reopened? And that's, that, I think that's pretty paramount in this discussion in my mind. If we, if the board closed them and said, hey, look, you know, Mr. Respondent, it's closed, we're not wrestling that issue anymore. I'm just a little bit concerned about that. And well, I know you look at it from a legal standpoint.
Right. Well, and if it was closed with prejudice, then I don't think that we would be looking at it, but we were hoping that it had been.
I don't think it was. I went back and looked because I thought in my – I thought it was, but then I looked back, and it didn't seem like in the files it was noted as with prejudice.
I didn't want us to go this through this exercise and that it had actually happened, and then it really kind of throw an egg at us. If that
right,
makes sense.
Yeah. Well, what we didn't want to happen is, you know, he just show up at the next meeting, and then you guys are hit with it out of left field, and you haven't had any time to review these. I mean, I don't know how old these complaints are. I think it was 2010 or 2011.
Yeah, it's been a while.
And so we'll have to get them from archives on legal side, most likely, and then I can get you.
If it was 2010 and 11, chances are somebody on this board, well, I would have guessed to be the only one that may have possibly even reviewed the case.
Right.
So you might want to look into that too,
mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah. Well, we will, but I think, you know, part of it is we can at least say that we took a look at it, you know, again, and that way we can all be sure and we can come in here at the next meeting and if he has, let him limit his time, because I don't know how I don't know how long he plans on speaking or how long it's going to take, but I think that the board has the authority to, you know, you can allow him to speak, but you can limit the time, certainly.
Right.
Well, and could we also be in this portion of our meeting and address this issue and sort of take care of it and let him speak afterwards?
Or? Oh.
No.
Well.
Let him speak prior?
During. And, you know, during the meeting, he has to, he can, that's his opportunity if the board. Opportunity to speak to the board.
What I'm saying, Nicole, is let him speak prior to us doing a legal review of this, which that's what it would ultimately be. It would be a legal review such similar to what we just did, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the board during the legal portion could make their recommendation regarding what they found after their review and just leave it at that, and then he can have his side of things and try to, I guess he's just going to stand there and try to persuade the board to reopen it anyway. But if the board makes...
I just sense with the efforts that he's made of it being an argumentative
yeah.
scenario.
Yeah. The board's previous decision is not subject to contest. I mean, you really not presented any new evidence. At all. And I've written a lot of letters. I've really tried to be super nice to this guy. Possible to his concerns. It's just, unfortunately, there is absolutely no way to sort of, I don't really know what his ultimate goal is other than drawing and quartering these two respondents. I mean, he seems like he has some personal crusade against these two land surveyors, which I don't know why he's got such an axe to grind against them.
Yeah.
He was happy that his case was dropped.
Yeah, Nicole, you said something interesting to me right there that caught me for a second. You said there's no new evidence that's been presented since the cases have already been ruled by this board. And that kind of almost like a double jeopardy type situation there. I would hate to see board change its opinion when no new evidence has been brought about. That sets a very dangerous precedent. Stop him from writing letters. We can't stop him from making phone calls. We can't stop him from voicing his opinion or coming to the board meetings. He's more than welcome to. Anybody is. Certainly would, you know, entertain the option for him to come and speak to the board. Absolutely. But I just kind of want to set some caution to the board, myself, everyone included, that if there's no new information here presented, the case is solved. The case is decided. Theory of reopening this without any real reason, and especially with
kind of want to set the caution flag.
And I mean, I'm in complete agreement with that statement. I think that the reviewer would just look at it just from, I don't know what term to use, just to try to placate the gentleman. I mean, try to look at it and see if there is anything that's completely just stands out at you as wrong. But short of that, then I don't think we could reopen it.
I know when we did the case review prior to the reviewer scenario, I know that the board at that time great length when we looked at each one of those individual cases. A lot of discussion and explanation about those cases when that scenario was how we did things. The board, moreover, just as we've spoke about the expert witness scenario, the board, moreover, knew what they were looking for and the questions they needed answers in order to come to a resolution. And so I feel very comfortable with whatever the members at that time decided about these cases. But, you know, from my standpoint, I'm more than willing, if it's my straw to draw or Jay's, and I'm sure Jay is too, more than willing to sit down and go through the information and provide you with any feedback or the board or both that may be necessary. It's not a problem at all.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Rolling.
Last director's report.
Director's report.
We'll let Donna do it since it's her last want time.
Well, thanks. Okay, legislative update. We don't have any this month. We need to set the meeting dates. Budget information, 2010-11 budget, our adjusted balance was 85.61. 2011-2012, it was okay. 2014-15 year to date as of April was what does this stand for? Expected. Our budget plan expenditures was $2,068. How do you say that? Total expenditures was $86,269. Our total revenue as of April of 2015 was $24,100 for 2014 fiscal year.
On the revenue stream, how has the FS exam affected, the change in the FS exam affected our? Saw a lot more monies.
Yeah.
And now NCWS.
I don't think it's really affected that much. We really won't see an upgrade to our revenue until the end of this year.
Well, and my concern there is our normal influx, you know, on the odd year. But next year we roll into the PS exam being CBT,
yeah,
which is another revenue stream change.
Wasn't that money passed through, though? Wasn't it just communicated to us and then passed through to the exam provider?
Yeah. Biggest part of it is, yes.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying that the overall structure of the budget, I mean, the numbers are going to start looking different again, just like they did after the FS.
Yeah. Like I said, there were no legislative updates this month. Next, we need to set 2016 meeting dates and discuss having one-day meetings going forward. Tentative dates are listed on here as January 21st, 2016 for an application review, April the 14th, 2016, July 28th, 2016 for application review, and October 27th, 2016.
I'd like to address the issue of the one-day slash two-day meetings. I'm all about efficiency and getting it through. If it can be knocked out in one day, I'm all about it. It does generate a little bit of a hardship on account of the board members that have to travel a great distance. I travel a fairly good distance. Tim, I know, travels by far the farthest of all of us. And that does generate a little bit of hardship to consolidate
down. If it's a one-day meeting, you can spend the night that night and get up the next morning and leave.
Yes.
And also, in addition, you know, when we have the addition of the application review, it does become lengthy. I guess what I'm getting at is I would like some leeway to when the agenda is generated, based on the amount of detail to cover in the agenda, that we'd be flexible to one day, two day. You know, if there's items on the agenda similar to today's, which is pretty lengthy, and lots of discussion and you know, if we have public members, things like that, it can tend to become a long day, especially if you're traveling. Whether you stay the night before or you stay the night after, it's somewhat of a hardship. I guess what I'd like is just some flexibility to, if it's a small agenda and it's short, perhaps we can cover it in one day. But if it's lengthy and there's expected to be some traffic involved, and I mean personnel traffic, that we have the ability to extend it to 2 days.
I really don't think that that's going to be feasible. I do not know this, but they merged a lot of programs under regulatory boards, and I now oversee 17 programs. And five of those programs have boards. So besides how many board meetings I now have to attend, I won't have Donna. Also, we'll have formal hearings on a regular basis sitting in front of ALJs. One-day meetings are going to be key. This is the... realize you guys have a lot of business, and I'm very respectful of that, but we're going to have to figure out some streamlining mechanisms to hold the meetings in one day. We're just going to have to, we're going to work on processing the applications so that you guys have less to review up front, checking the education, checking all of that, so that you really are focused on looking at the plats. You know, we'll have checklist items down pat. We'll have them sent to you in advance. We're going to change the processes so that everything is done as quickly and as streamlined as as possible for you, so that we use your time well during our board meetings, to allow you to be able to use your time here for discussion, for hearings, for legal reports, for the business of the board. But unfortunately, I just can't do two-day meetings. I really can't.
Okay, I understand that. It on the other topic, dealing with the length of the meetings, the ability to stay overnight.
Definitely, you can do that.
I understand the one night. I'm all about the one night. Here's my issue. If we're to consolidate to one day, and let's just say we do a standard 9 to 5 meeting, which could happen today. And what's your approximate drive time from Kingsport to here?
4 hours.
4 hours. So over 4 hours. Yeah. So he's allowed to stay one night, either the night before or the night after. Is he allowed to? That's my question. Is he allowed two nights?
Two nights.
Or any of us allowed two
and
nights?
You don't necessarily have to stay in Nashville. If you want to drive part of the way home to get yourself a good distance home, save that receipt, email it to me. We'll get you stayed. State rate on the way home. You know, if you want to just get out of Nashville so that you're out of the traffic. you know, like, okay. Oh, I'm going to drive 2 hours and I'm going to stay somewhere along the drive home.
Sure.
So, that yeah, helps. We can accommodate. We can work with you to make this as easy as possible.
All right. One other issue on those dates, the April 14th date, I think, Tim, is that
yes.
What we had mentioned? The April 14th date is the week after the Southern Conference is here for NCWS, which is in Nashville this year. I wondered if we could possibly change that date to, which I think the conference is Thursday through Saturday?
It's the 7th through the 9th.
Okay, so Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Right.
Can we change the 14th date to be the 6th? Is that the day before?
Mm-hmm.
6th. I know these are all Thursday dates. But it's just... It seems silly to drive up here for a 3-day conference, go home, and then come right back the next week. If we could move that to the day before, that's the efficiency that you were talking about.
Let's see, April 6th. I'm going to have to write it down and check and see if I can get a room. April 6th.
Right. Is that right, Tim, the 6th?
Yes, sir.
I didn't check it personally.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I will check the date, and I will email you if it's confirmed, okay?
April 6th is a Wednesday, and the meeting is the 7th through the 9th.
Yeah. That would help.
I will say at this point in time that I know John sent out, I know we're digressing a little bit, I know John sent out structure for the Southern Zone meeting, but clearly, somehow or another, he hadn't got my question is. My question is what is our involvement? Or, you know, how are we going to be involved in the management of the thing being here? In other words, you know, somebody's got to register people and somebody's got to do this and do that. We just came from a Southern Zone meeting that the two states involved, there was two states involved. It was actually a joint meeting. It was Southern and Western. And the two host states had a disagreement the day, well, actually a few days before, and it escalated the day of, and they had issues of having people staffing the desk and all this kind of stuff. Now, obviously, it's just us. It's just a Southern Zone meeting.
Yeah.
But still, that just brought to mind that, you know, there's some logistics that's got to be taken care of, because I feel sure that John may be thinking that Nicole is going to provide some staff, and he's going to provide some staff, whatever staff that you all have under your discretion, to go and help with that type of thing. But we, in fact, also may have to help in some capacity, which is fine. I have no problem with that at all. Be glad to help. We're glad to have the folks come here.
John did talk to me a little bit, but he was just asking questions about hotels and certain amenities. I recently coordinated a very large for the Association of Appraiser Regulatory Officials. If John needs any help, I'm certainly glad to help him with that. I'm glad to lend whatever assistance is necessary in guiding him to do that. Our conference went off without a hitch. What happened was some cookies weren't delivered, but other than that, and we had so much food we didn't know what to do with it all. So the cookies being not delivered was not that big of a deal.
The other thing that misses here is, we were unable to coordinate a meeting this year with the engineering committee, and we tipped because our dates didn't coincide. And I would really respectfully request that while you're checking dates, that you check with John and see when the engineering committee is going to meet, so that we have an opportunity. We have some commonality between what each of us do and part of why we like to meet with them.
Can we do that at the Southern Zone meeting?
Well, not actually at the committee. The engineering committee probably will not be at the meeting.
Okay. What time of the year is that generally? Does that generally
occur? We've been doing it in April. That's when we've been doing it. It didn't happen this year. didn't happen this year. We last year was the last time, and I don't know. Have you been to one of them, Jay?
No.
See, Jay hadn't even been to one of them. So I would like to, you know, do that. And then we have discussion coming up later in our board meeting about the TS examination that may, in fact, potentially affect the July and the October meetings that we're discussing that we normally have. We may end up in a different month or scenario. May even end up with more meetings than less at one day.
Well, another option is we can hold teleconference meetings for short business. Like if we had to hold things like all in, and we could hold legal report, and I don't know, I guess we couldn't do the applications because you need two sign-offs, but let's say we had just had a legal report and a couple of other matters that needed discussed. You could do that by teleconference. You wouldn't have to drive all the way in, and then we could handle it in 30 minutes or 45 minutes or whatever by phone, and it would save the board time and expense and effort. But we could do it by public necessity just to get the board business taken care of and moving forward. Just documents, if there's any. I've done that for five of the boards in the last 2 months. So that's another thing we can start considering. You know, certainly any of you could come down. I'm not saying any of you wouldn't have to, but if somebody were busy or unable to attend, you can always attend by teleconference. Like it says right at the bottom of every agenda, a board member can attend by teleconference. So if someone it were a strain on their time to be here, pick up the phone. We wouldn't want to do that if there were a lot of business. You just have to dedicate a meeting to that, you know, one of these meetings. That may just be the meeting, you know, just do a legal report and the exam, period. We're just going to have to dedicate a meeting, you know, content specific meeting.
Anyway, that's just a couple of things that we need to consider before we formalize these dates.
Have to formalize them because there's only two rooms in this building, and they book not only the boards that and commissions that you're familiar with in this building, but anyone in any licensing, anybody from the state of Tennessee can book these rooms. So they go fast, and you see how fancy and nice they are. If we don't book them now, they're going to be gone. So I have to book them and put them on the calendar and hold the spot. If I don't formalize your schedule, it's over for the year. Your calendar is gone. And then we meet on Friday at 4 p.m. because those are the only times nobody wants.
Can you change them after you, like, if we formalize them today, if something came up, can you?
Only if it's not already booked. It's like, you know, you get the leftovers of whatever times are left on the calendars. Right? It just starts to get really difficult to get one of these two rooms.
I object.
I do too.
So do I. Anyway, we needed to, we would, I guess. All right, let's see, where else? How far did we get?
Motion to approve those dates, is that what you need? All right, well, I'll go ahead and make the motion to approve those dates as listed, subject to Nicole's efforts to check on the April 6th date in place of the April 14th, and also to try and coordinate with the Engineers Board, try and get a joint meeting there on one of those dates that we have listed.
Second. Any further discussion? Hearing none.
Aye.
Opposed? We'll go with the.
Next thing is, information is needed for the newsletter. Information is needed for the newsletter. So if y'all have anything, or you know anybody that has anything they want to contribute, just email that to CodyKimmer@tn.gov. He's our newspaper writer guy. Okay.
Content writers, if you know people who are even college professors who are good at writing articles, just get us the contacts. We need to start building land surveyor.
Next thing is continuing education that needs to be reviewed. And I think I've got it all backwards in your books as opposed to what's on here. I think the first one would be the individual, which is Scott Barrett. And the only reason I present this is because it is a vendor who is no longer in business. If you don't know who I'm talking about.
Well, Mr. Barry. Business as a sole proprietor type, offering surveying services, is that what you're saying?
No, offering surveying courses. He's not a licensed surveyor either. His courses had been pre-approved, but this guy's from out of state, so that's why I didn't know whether we should approve him or not. Before that page. Tim, it's before that. That one. Certificate, you know what I'm talking about.
Gentleman from South Carolina. Yeah. Bider is the son of the registrant that died. And this has happened when? What's in 2014? We had already addressed that prior to that, had we not?
Yeah, we had. But the reason I'm asking is because this guy's out of state. It's okay. That's what I want to.
He has no. It's my opinion. This is personal. And the other board members can have their opinions, clearly. But it's my opinion, none of the hours he has submitted qualify for continuing education for state, mainly because these are Kentucky, South Carolina, Kentucky, and Alabama.
And I have to agree with Tim. But since he didn't take anything in Tennessee, it's not applicable here.
Now, is he submitting these for 2015? Is that what he was submitting these for?
You know what? I forgot to even look, but I think so.
Because that's his form he has, is the 14-15 renewal form. So whichever year he's submitting them for, 14 or 15, they don't qualify.
Yeah, Yeah, because I got this in January. And then the next one, and I've got these backwards. The next one is William Thompson.
I would like to request that Mr. Thompson come before this board. He has become a problem, in my opinion, and I think he needs to come before this board because this board has reviewed his courses on multiple occasions. The advisory board has reviewed his courses on multiple occasions. There have been recommendations made by the advisory committee. I should have said board, advisory committee. This board has reviewed those recommendations, has properly made motions and submitted and returned through your office back to him what we did approve.
Well, these courses that he has submitted, he is submitting for renewal. And the committee recommended their hours. Less hours than he was asking for.
And that has been the mode of operation since he has submitted courses to this board. And I think that the only way we're going to head this guy off is to have him come right there and we talk to him eyeball to eyeball and get him to understand what we expect for these courses. Okay. Because I have a hard time when somebody submits a course, Donna, that says that they want 8 hours credit for it, mm-hmm. and the advisory committee said it's worth one. There's something a matter there.
Right, and he wrote in there, letters in there, why he should have more hours.
Well, but, you know, I know it takes time to prepare a course.
I'm telling you.
Put the paperwork, the video, whatever it is kind of course you have, it takes time to present that. But the fact that you spent X number of hours crafting a course does not mean that its latent value is an arbitrary number that you assign to it. When we have folks that review this for content and context, etc., to yield X number of hours. And I just think that, you know, this gentleman is a problem with his courses. They may be wonderful courses, but obviously there's a situation that the advisory committee does not feel that, you know, when he asks for, in this case, 8 times the value, most of his courses he's asked it anywhere from 2 to 4 times. Now he's asking for 8 times the value that the committee has decided. So, I mean, I just feel like that's excessive.
I mean, sorry, I just have to interject. I don't know if we have the authority to require him to come up here. I think that certainly limiting the number of credit hours that you're going to attribute to his courses is certainly understandable. That's completely within your discretion. However,
I think I said we should ask him to come before this board. Asking is required.
No, I mean, I understood it as requiring, but okay. I mean, you can
said it that way. I apologize.
Okay.
I stand corrected.
Well, you can ask him certainly to come voluntarily, but I don't know, since he's not an actual licensee or, you know.
Yeah, he's a licensee.
Okay, but isn't he just, what's the violation? He's just.
That's not a violation.
Okay. Let me see if I can just kind of wrap this up a little bit. Is it my understanding correctly that he's requesting a renewal of the courses?
Right, and he was asking for more hours.
For
than
additional
been,
hours.
Been awarded.
Is that okay?
Previously.
Well, let me ask you this, Tim. Does the board have any problem with approving the reassignment of these courses for the upcoming year with the existing hours that have been previously approved?
No.
Okay. So.
Right. And the question, the committee sent their responses back, and they wanted to know why he was asking for more hours than they were going to give him credit for. And they asked me to send him an email and ask him that. And he responded to that the other day. This was back in April when I asked him, and he responded the other day in the packet.
Okay.
And also, there are some letters in there from, like, 3 or 4 surveyors telling him why his classes are great.
Well, what I would suggest is if it's the purview of the board here to approve the hours that have been previously approved for renewal,
we can do that.
And that if he wishes to apply for additional hours, that we request his presence here at the next meeting, in which case we could consider it then. If he doesn't show up, he's got his approval for the hours that they exist already. If he's adamant about trying to get additional hours, we can request his presence. Otherwise, it stays status quo.
I think that's fine.
Yeah. I understand that. Yeah.
Write that down.
How to use the word request? I didn't get to. I'm mad.
All right, motion on the floor.
We are back and ready to resume. There is a motion on the floor that we have not completed. So, Jay, restate the motion again.
Oh, I was afraid you were going to say that. The gist of the motion was that we approve the original hours of Mr. Thompson's application as they exist today for renewal for his courses that he administers, and that if he wishes to extend the hours on those same courses, that we request his presence here at the next meeting, to which case he can state the reasons why.
Motion has been made.
I'll second that motion.
Motion is seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Now the next ones are, and they're behind these, or they're from McKissick. They're renewals. Separately, there they are. The committee approved these at first, and they decided to wait because these are correspondence courses. So they wanted y'all to look at them to make sure they were worthy of approval. Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Please don't.
Oh, yeah,
let's put it this way. I reviewed them. I didn't read them. Pages, I think, that came to us to review. So, you know.
That's what I said. Really? And passed on.
These have all been approved before. They're just renewing them.
Requesting renewal of 9 online correspondence courses.
And these are the same hours that were previously approved for. The ones that
okay, discussion on McKissick's request.
I've read through them, and I don't see any problem. And they're coming back with the same thing, and I've not heard any feedback from, you know, registrants that feel like that there's issues or anything with them. Make a motion that we approve the McKissick submittal as stated.
I second it.
Second. Question. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next.
All right. I've got some PLSIC certificates to sign, two of them. And then our next thing would be to review applications. We have seven fundamental applications, FS applications, two PS applications, three PSTS applications, and 25 TS applications, for a total of 37 applications.
As one says, hold him.
Let's get cracking.
We have to do the board business first before we go to new business, which is a general discussion needs to be at the end. We got to keep to the general order. I'm very passionate about this. I know that the board business needs to happen, but if we can get the content going, I can get staff working on this. This is Donna's last day. That's why I'm passionate about this. I want you to understand my reasoning for this. If we can get this going, I can have staff upstairs working on this as we go.
Donna, do we have TS certificates from April?
They haven't got it back yet.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. They just picked them up about a week ago.
I mean, if I certainly could have the TABS report be before we do application review, but it's just, we got to get.
Going then through the budget report, and we're ready then for application review other than. All right, if we have time to do what.
Then that to me is mission critical board business, is getting those applications reviewed.
Sure. Now the fundamentals applications were sent to y'all. Have y'all had a chance to look at those? That's with those.
I think we can pause the video because it makes the video run really long watching you guys do paper.
So, you gotta have a guy. I think there's one other thing that Mr. Cleveland had that he wanted to present to us.
Before he does, Mr. Chairman, are we going to table the determination of the GPS in order to let Mr. Cleveland finish so we can conclude and then we bring it back in the morning and make a decision in the morning?
Yes, I think that's.
Is that appropriate?
That's fine with me. Mm-hmm. If you want to do that particular thing.
Thank you, sir. Sorry to interrupt.
Mr. Chairman, I noticed on the agenda here you've got monumentation on all easements as a topic of discussion. Being a surveyor that's licensed in Mississippi, they require the monumentation of all easements, and I can tell you down there that there is a lot of discussion. There's a lot of surveyors that aren't real happy about that, and the reason is one, well, there's several different reasons. A couple of reasons that come to my mind is, one, it substantially increases the cost of a survey. Two, I believe it exposes us to greater liability in that we have a hard enough time getting one call to come out and locate utilities as it is for property corners, much less coming out and locating utility service lines or something like that, maybe on a piece of property. And if we're required to go out and monument easements with a 18-inch rebar, we're going to basically, I personally have surveyed many properties that have numerous easements just crisscrossing it all over. And I think that was going to, one, create pin farms, and two, if we're required to cap those monuments with our license number, I think it's going to create mass confusion on certain sites. And as I've spoken with some of my fellow surveyors, I think a lot of these easements are already monumented, whether it be sewer manholes, say a sewer easement monumented by sewer manholes. They can be retraced that way, or power, or power easement, electric easements or something like that. A lot of these easements can already be retraced. So I think, this being just coming up, this being the first time I've seen this, I personally am opposed to it, and I'm sure that we would, depending on how this board reacts or how this board decides to move forward, if we bring it up at the board of directors meeting in September, I can assure you that TAPS will have a lot of comments on it as well. So I think it's going to create an undue burden on not only the surveyor but also on the public as well.
I agree 100%. We start crisscrossing properties, pinning these and you may have a record of an easement, and you go out and actually pin that record easement, and the utility's not inside it. Utility's not landing inside the easement, or doesn't stay in the center line of that easement.
I don't necessarily disagree. I think that our standards of practice do not address easements in some manner that they should, from a standpoint of dictionary, but locatability. I think you understand what I mean. So I think that in the spirit of that statement, I think that that is a function of surveyors in surveying easements. I know we've all done many of them. But the same token, the locatability, again, is important. And yes, you're right, Danny, that many times you've come up on an easement that on paper it's here, on the ground it's here, and the utility that is to be defined by it is someplace else. So that's not uncommon at all. But I think it's something that, as time goes on, should be discussed relative to the standards of practice about how it should be managed in a methodology that would, again, going back to the GPS, that would make it a little bit more retraceable or locatable. Obviously, you've dealt with many easements that are general in nature. But this language here is speaking more to specific easements that need to be defined that would affect or determine, for example, structure location on a property, things of that nature. That's just kind of my thought about that.
I'd like to, if this is something we're going to, that the board is going to talk about, at future meetings, I've got a very good example plat that I did in Arkansas that I actually have had numerous conversations with Mr. Joe Bird, who was a member of the surveyor member of the Mississippi Board, and he and I were going back and forth clarifying some issues on the confusion that several of the surveyors in the northwest part of Mississippi were having regarding monumenting easements. And I sent him this particular plat for a hospital subdivision over in Arkansas. and it, pardon my country speech here, but it was just eaten up with easements. I mean, just numerous easements and odd configurations and crisscrossed all over the place. And I would, you know, if this is something you guys, you know, the board would like to look at, I could show you that, and it would absolutely be a nightmare to monument. And that's kind of what I foresee on some of these larger commercial sites.
Well, in the same spirit, I could bring you a plat on a hospital site that I did in Georgetown, Kentucky, that, again, to use your terminology, is eat up with easements, that we had to describe not only the center line of the easement, but all the easement.
Right.
And, I mean, the map is unbelievable when you when you look at it. But the thing about it is it's all locatable.
Well, I agree wholeheartedly with being able to locate it, and maybe even doing this. In this particular instance, we did one sheet, had the boundary information. The second sheet was strictly – we took the boundary information off and strictly used the second sheet for describing the easements, and would have used a third sheet if we needed to. But something along that line, I think would serve the public better to clarify those, you know, whatever we needed to do. Because I agree 100%, we need to make those easements retraceable. But as far as actually physically monumenting them, I think it would cause a lot of confusion in the field on the ground.
Possibly a better terminology for that would be record corners for easements, because you know you can have a record corner with no monument.
I think
that's sort of what we're discussing.
Correct. I think physically monumenting them, unless it's a contractual obligation, because I have had done certain surveys where they were contractually required to be monumented, and that's a specific case. But to come back in and do some of the surveys that I've personally done and with my brief career, and as I'm sure everybody on that sitting over there is as well, you know, there's some that would just be unbelievably difficult to monument, and you go out and start finding dozens of corners and in a small area when you got a lot of easements that are overlapping each other. It could create a whole lot of confusion. Not to mention putting a rebar through a gas line, has happened to me before. It's not fun.
My firm did that too.
I left. Sorry to say that, guys.
I'm teaching well.
Well, and I guess we all have those opinions and ideas about these particular things, and I'm whenever you monument something, and every time I fail to see that monumenting all over the lot, and he came to me and asked me, "What are all these stakes out here?" And I said, "You asked me to stake the easements." The realtor wanted it so he could sell the place. I said, "Excuse me, not loud enough."
So. For me, I mean, it's nothing more than what's been said here already. Majority of the easements are already monumented, usually by physical structure. in the underground, in a way, are monumented as well. You just can't see the monuments. They're pipelines of some sort. You know, are we going to have to call, 800-LOCATE to spray paint? Most, if not some, easements, and I'm just going off memory here, so don't quote me, are required. But quite honestly, just on the surface, I just can't see that a blanket statement of way up, not just in time and effort, but materials as well. Ability of hitting a utility when setting some sort of monument to mark whatever kind of skyrockets. It's just, I just don't see the benefit to it. Monument that, I'd like to see it. That's a heck of a trick. But you know, there's all sorts. We could go for days here about what ifs and how come and how would we address it. Ways, or it's improvements, or it's utilities of some sort.
Just on Mississippi for clarification.
Do you have it with you?
I do happen to have it. If an easement is performed in conjunction with a boundary survey lying adjacent and parallel, monumentation is not required. Is not required. If in the event an easement survey is performed independent of a boundary survey, monumentation is required. So that's what Mississippi says.
Yeah, I knew there was some caveat in there.
Yeah. I would, Mr. Chairman, like to ask Mr. Cleveland, because I know we're getting down to the last few moments of today's session. I think you maybe also wanted to speak on the TS exam that we're going to be discussing, potentially, about the take-home exam.
We briefly talked about that. Mr. Northcutt made a mention of that at the June TAPS Board of Directors meeting, and I kind of had got some mixed reaction to that. I don't know if some of that was being not kind of, I guess, reluctance to change. But pardon me. But of course, we all know that times are changing, so we know there's going to have to be some change. I'm not sure what direction the board's looking at going to. There hasn't been enough time elapsed for TAPS at this point to formulate an opinion on it. So I'm sure it's being discussed at the chapter level. We can solicit comments to be discussed next month at the September Board of Directors meeting, and I'd be more than willing to offer suggestions at that point. But of course, we know at the same time it's going to be a Board of Examiners decision. Taking my TAPS hat off for a second, I did like the way Kentucky, I'm a newly licensed licensee in Kentucky. I did like the way they handled it, you know, had it at the board office, you know, when they have enough examinees to do that. But, you know, that's the first state I've ever done that in. So that was kind of new to me, but I thought they handled it really well. So just maybe something to think about. I know a couple of the initial concerns were, you know, exam security and things like that was just some off the cuff remarks we heard there at the meeting. But like I said, there hasn't been, TAPS hasn't had enough time to talk to us, the general membership, and offer any, you know, formulate any official opinions at this time.
Chair, if I might address the board. If the board gets to the point where the Tennessee-specific examination is ready by the board office administratively. We already are capable of doing that. We already handle the examination proctor for the professional geologists. We proctor their examinations. It's not a burden on our staff. We just do it periodically through the year. We could almost do it on a one-off basis where we just put them in a enclave and let them take the test. I mean, it's not really that difficult to secure an applicant to take an examination. Board needs that service provided for the land surveyors. We have the ability. Difficult part that we will have to continue to do is contract the subject matter expert to develop the exam questions to make sure that the data pool for the questions continues to be viable.
That's the biggest thing right now, and coming up April of 16 is when I think we want to consider starting to do our own exam again. Whether we do it as an open book, a take-home exam, or what have you, and as I just mentioned when I was at the Board of Directors meeting for TAPS, I just mentioned the fact that we are considering some other options, and one of the options I mentioned was an open book test, and eyebrows, and then after the meeting was over, and I was there at least at break time, and a couple of individuals said, "I'm not in favor of this at all." And I said, "Well, I understand, because years ago we all went in and we all sat in a closed book and had to sweat with the palms and go through the exam and what have you, but what are we looking for?" And so we haven't decided yet what we're going to do with that or how it's going to be administered. Having that capability is fine, and I think that we're going to have to make use of what we have available to us and resources as far as issuing and grading the proctoring the exam. But right now, we haven't made a decision which way we need to go. And in fact, I really would like comments to come back from TAPS, because there may be several other ways that this could be done. But Tim, having worked with NCAAS and EPS, committee over there has seen and have an example of a take-home exam, and I have taken a look at it, and really interesting, but it's just one of those avenues that we just haven't explored all of the ramifications of each. Maybe I will attend that, and it could be maybe a couple of us might attend that.
Well, I will get Ms. Lori to send out a email, or I'll craft a letter and have her send it out to the Board of Directors to solicit comments about the upcoming change. And if it's okay, I may go ahead and send it to you, Ms. Nicole. That way you guys can make sure I'm getting the wording right, because I don't want to raise any eyebrows. You know, I want to make sure that the letter appropriately addresses expresses your desire for opinions. That way, when it goes out, we can have some comments come back at our September meeting, which should be in time for us to represent those opinions at your October board meeting. Because I know time is going to be of the essence in this matter. So,
yeah. Next board is scheduled for October.
I think last year is in October. That's the only reason I said October. So
October, I think 22nd, 20th. No,
our TAPS meeting is towards the 26th or 27th, somewhere around there. So we'll have time.
That's September,
to
yeah.
Yes, sir. So we'll have time to get that and get that to you.
And,
so
and get comments back, and we're going to. The National NCAAS Conference, the 19th of August, which is coming up next month, and there may be some information that Tim not sure, and so that's just something that we need to explore, because we're going to have to start doing it in 2016.
Well, just briefly, what's driving this is the fact that the PS exam is going CBT effective October the 1st, 2000. So that was okay, but what happened was NCWS said emphatically that they would no longer proctor the state specific or the jurisdictional surveying examinations. And the reason they said that was those exams would have to be given at the same time the paper and pencil PE exam was given. So they said, we're doing a PE exam, we're not doing a PE jurisdictional exam, because we can't guarantee there's enough seats, nor can we guarantee our proctor can handle your people. So you'd have to, at a minimum, have to have your own proctor, which I couldn't see was a big deal. But so they just made the board of directors for NCWS just made a policy and just said, hey, no more. You all, as a jurisdiction, need to handle your own exam, whatever it takes. That's why we're wearing this set of shoes, and we'll, of course, discuss it some more tomorrow. But how come we're here and talking about this is because it's now every jurisdiction then there's NCWS domain is wearing the same set of shoes as we are. All on them. Some states already have CBT exams. Some states do take home. Some states do a variety of things. They do, you know, office exams, etc. So there's a lot of stuff that's out there, but we just need to kind of discuss, you know, because if you think about it, we're actually at August 2015. And April 2016 is the last dual paper and pencil administered exam for PSTS for us. So that's our initial window, so that we have, that's our initial working window to get ready for what we're going to do if we decide that we want to stay on an April and October cycle. Simply because NCWS has now made the FS and we'll be making the PS to where it can be taken any day of the week, any month of the year. See, you know, when they first started the FS, they were doing a two-month window on and a one-month off. Well, they thought they needed the time to handle the data, so forth and so on. They now decide they don't need the time. We'll just go on with it. Of course, you know, for them, it's not only FS, it's FE on the CBT side. So the PS is just going to be another CBT exam, and they said it won't be any problem for Pearson View just to handle it, so it'd be given every day. So that's another football for the jurisdictions to handle, make a decision. You know, if you take the PS exam CBT October 1, you get your results back, let's say October 10, just to pick a date, and you could send an application into your jurisdiction, you know, could by December 1 you be taking a jurisdictional test. So, I mean, that's part of this whole scenario of how that needs to play out and how we need to kind of figure out how we want to do it. And part of it is just aptly so what Nicole mentioned earlier is we just need to determine a management style of how we're going to do it, a routine of when we're going to do it, just some of those logistics, and then start fitting all the rest of this puzzle into it. All the things that it takes to actually make it happen. So that, and that's what we'll discuss tomorrow. But I wanted to let you know about the CBT scenarios and stuff while you're here.
I don't believe so. Do you think anything else that we've talked about, any board of directors meeting that we need to represent?
I have one other question, and that's it.
I think TAPS is We appreciate the opportunity to be here. Thank you.
You had Danny. Chairman,
I have six acquaintances that are land surveyors who've asked me to ask this question, and when they find out this is on YouTube, they're everyone going to tune in to. But those six surveyors work for a private company that maintain the upkeep of federal properties, and those six surveyors want to know if their work as land surveyors is under the jurisdiction of this board, because many of their superiors are telling them they don't have to follow the state of Tennessee requirements for land surveying because they work on federal property.
They may be partly right, but they may be partly wrong. Of title of anything that joins to or what have you. Federal property, I don't know that I
I can recall offhand is that if the person surveying the property is an worked for the BLM and they came in and surveyed but that's not what you're asking. Basically, these are private surveyors who are under contract to survey on federal property.
Privately owned corporation.
Right.
Maintaining federal property.
Right.
TVA.
I think he's going to want to look that one up, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that I'm prepared to give any kind of...
I'm certainly not.
...opinion on
is TVA
that
private?
Question.
TVA private? Interesting.
I mean, that's going to require some.
When we talk about TVA property, I mean, we're not talking right of ways. We're talking about property that they own.
Owned by TVA?
Right. But this is also acquisition of properties outside of TVA proper for transmission substations. This is also.
Outside of TVA property.
They are acquiring the property. It will be TVA property once they make the purchase.
All right, we're transferring title. So once you're transferring title. Mm-hmm. It's under state standards.
That's a boundary survey. That's a boundary, Tennessee Category 1 boundary survey.
My opinion offhand would be that needs to be a Tennessee license.
Your opinion was?
My opinion is everything that's in that blue book. I don't think that they're not in charge of GPS operations of any type, and I don't think or a non-surveyor transferring or doing a survey of property or transfer. Okay. But I'm you guys gave us some good teeth when you gave us that rule on GPS, and I'll
oh, probably not. But did that answer what you expected to hear, maybe when they go on YouTube and look at this?
Maybe.
I think the answer may be different if the property is already owned.
Also, probably do well to consult with their private attorney to advise them on whether or not they're in compliance with the law, because I can't, as the board attorney, I can't I give the board opinions to make sure that they're operating by the law, but I can't give private entities or licensees legal opinion. So,
well, let me give you a parallel course. If TDOT, which is a state agency, so what makes TVA different other than they're a quasi-federal government entity? They're still doing the same thing. Transfer of title. I think Galen hit the key words, transfer of title. You know, if, for example, TVA surveyors are surveying on a TVA reservation, a.k.a. a dam site or whatever it may be, then they can do whatever they want to, as far as I'm concerned. They leave that site to survey 50 acres to acquire it to become part of that reservation. They need to be a licensed surveyor. Now, here's the other side of that. If you investigate TVA, if you investigate TDOT, they got plenty of surveyors. So there is no need for them not to do what they should do. That's the best.
I guess that question has been answered then?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Gentlemen and ladies, it's 5 after 5, yep. 6 after 5, and I'm tired, and we.
Second.
Any further discussion? Good. All opposed? Don't.
Early.